Well, thank you, Laura. That was very, very nice and very appropriate and very true. And we do owe God our life without doubt or question. And I think maybe during the announcements I was talking a little fast. Try to slow down and pace myself. It seems like when we rush to Prestonsburg and rush back, and you just get in a fast mode and everything's fast. But that could mean I could end this sermon in 15 minutes, but probably not. So, but I do have a confession I have to make, and I found this out coming home from Prestonsburg as Debbie and Bill and Darlene went with us, and we reviewed a few things, including my points. I do have points. However, I cannot give you a number or an alphabet to either any of my points. Because it seems that I have two or three number two points. I have an A, B, and a D, but I don't have a C. So I don't know what I did. Part of it was I started this sermon on Monday, had it 95% done by Tuesday. By Tuesday evening, I realized this is not working. So I thought about it Wednesday. And I had some more notes for Thursday and realized this is not working. So Friday, I scrapped it all and started over. Friday evening. So, but it's still the same, mostly part of the same notes, but it's been a rough week, to say the least. So I'm going to give you points, but I'm not going to tell you this is point one, two, or three. I'm just going to say this is the next point. And you can make your own outline. Maybe that'll be better. I don't know. But anyway, let's get started. So, we've been talking about Zechariah in our Bible studies, and it's very interesting. I think the book of Zechariah, all the chapters are really neat. If you haven't read ahead yet, I highly recommend you do that and check them out, because there's a lot of history and a lot of information. But I made a mistake. What we should have done was covered maybe Ezra and Haggai before we covered Zechariah. So, I'm going to make up for that mistake. Today, I want to talk about Haggai, chapter 1. Because this ties right in. Okay. This ties right in to Zechariah. And in the early chapters of where we're at right now with Zechariah. And I think you'll see this. You know, the message of the prophet Haggai, and again, we know this from Zechariah, it takes place in 520 B.C., and that's when this started. This was after Nebuchadnezzar had plundered, I should say, Jerusalem. He went in and destroyed it, tore it up, and in doing that, he took the people captive. He took them back to Babylon, kept them for 70 years. 70 years, the Israelites suffered this exile, and then Cyrus came to power. Cyrus came as the leader of the Medo-Persian Empire. So he came into power, and he defeated the Babylonians, which was a great relief for these Israelites. It allowed the Israelites to return to their homeland. Ezra took about 50,000 Jews and returned back to the area we call the Holy Land, or Jerusalem area. Now, the book of Ezra tells us that the first thing the people did was rebuild a temple. Let's take a quick look at that as we get started here. Ezra chapter 3. Read verses 2 and 3. Ezra 3, verse 2 and 3. Then Joshua, the son of Jozadak, and his brethren, the priests, and Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and his brethren arose and built the altar of the God of Israel to offer burnt offerings on it, as it was written in the law of Moses, the man of God. Verse 3. Though fear had come upon them because the people of those countries, they set the altar on its bases and they offered burnt offerings on it to the Lord, both the morning and the evening burnt offerings. So that's just a very, very snippet, if you will, of history. They returned, and this is where it really starts getting important. They returned from this exile with a sense of repentance, a repentance for the sins of their fathers. And that led, those sins led to the destruction of Jerusalem. And again, we know that from our studies so far in Zechariah. They sensed a need for sacrifices for their own sins. And that is also important because they realized they sinned as well. And this is great. This parallels us today. We need to realize these same things. We all need a sacrifice for sin. And as we well know, the true sacrifice is none other than the death of Jesus Christ as he died on the cross or the stake or whatever, wherever you want to say it. But there's more. There's more to being a Christian than just receiving the forgiveness of our sins. Once we are converted, that's only the beginning. We need to live a life at that point of obedience and commitment to God and God's ways, all of God's ways. We need to put Christ first in our lives in absolutely everything that we do, without exception. We need to worship him regularly. And that doesn't mean just on the Sabbath. That means every day of our life. We need to worship God. Soon after the Israelites here, going back to Hezekiah, soon after the Israelites built the altar, they immediately laid the foundation for the temple. It was so important to them to get that temple rebuilt. And that's as it should be. This temple would play a vital role, an absolute vital role in the survival of their faith of all these Israelites that came out of this exile. Think about that. I don't know that any of us here have ever been in a situation like that. They came out of this. This was life-changing. And their first thing was to offer sacrifices to God and rebuild the temple. And that's great. Without the temple, it is doubtful that that religion, the religion of the Israelites, could have survived the onslaught of this pagan world. You think about that. Look at this world we live in today. How pagan is it? We are right in the middle, right on the brink of this season that the world is hitting us right in the face with. I don't know how many people just this week alone has asked me if my Christmas shopping is done yet. I said, yeah, it's done. It's been done quite a while. It's been done about 45 years. I don't say that. That would be a little smart aleck. But the point is, this is the world we live in. I had one guy ask me, hey, do you celebrate Christmas? I said, no, I do not. And then, for the next 20 minutes, I quickly explained why. And that was a good conversation. But my point is, it's everywhere. This is the world we live in. We have to face it. We can't, you know, we're to come out of the world, but we still have to live in this world and deal with people. We can't just be a hermit and be lost. In spite of the good intentions of these people, going back to Hezekiah, it wasn't long before the enthusiasm of God in their life abandoned them. Now, God didn't leave them. They left God. They decided that they had other priorities. Different things was more important to them. So they abandoned the work of God. They abandoned the finishing of the temple. For 15 years, the people did absolutely nothing on the temple. They let it stand. They started out well, and their intentions were great in this renewed faith that they had, but they stopped. What they absolutely did was they came short of obedience to God. Now I call the title of this message, It's Time to Get Our House in Order. And when I say this, we'll get into this just a little bit deeper here in a minute, but I think you'll see the difference in house, what that means. when you think about what went on back in Hezekiah's time, it's a lot of the same thing that goes on today. So many people, and we've all seen this, and I hope none of us are guilty of it, but we've all seen it. So many people start out in the faith. They're on fire. You couldn't stop them with a block wall if you had to. They're on fire. That's what they live. And it's a great thing. How long is it before that fire? Now, I'm not saying it burns out, but it does dwindle quite a bit. And the next thing you know, they're almost just going through the motions. That's what happened. It's what happened back in Hezekiah's day. It happened before that, and it happened after that. And it's happening today. And it will not quit happening until Christ returns and puts an end to this world, this physical world that we live in. When people first come into the church, though, they're excited about it. And that's a great thing. And that's the excitement that we all that have been around for 40 and 50 years or however long, that's the excitement that we need to harness. That's how we help each other. We build off of that. Brother, I sincerely believe that the time that we live in now, this time has come that we absolutely have to get our house in order. And I say that, again, with two statements, a literal house and a figurative house. Yes, the literal house is our home, our dwelling, what we do behind closed doors, when we leave here, when we are not in the world anymore. God still sees us. God knows. Is that house in order? Now, figuratively, I want to talk about the spiritual house, the spiritual temple. Us, individually, we are the temple of God. Is that house in order? Is it ready for God to dwell in it? That's the question I want to look at. I believe that there are some very important principles that we can draw on from this first chapter of Hezekiah or Haggai. And I think these principles will help all of us, no matter where we are, move forward in our spiritual life, our spiritual preparation. So if you will, let's go to Haggai, and we'll look at chapter 1. And you might put a marker here because we're going to be going in and out of this a lot, but we will look at pretty much all of chapter 1 here. So, my first point, or a point that I'm going to start with, you know, I want to talk, first of all, about the first principle is a problem that we should avoid. And this is, so often we postpone obedience to God. So often we postpone obedience to God. Now, we can think, you know, I've been a Christian for a long time. And I am obedient to God. Are we? Always? I mean, there's all kinds of questions we can add to that. You know, I would venture to say that absolutely none of us are obedient to God 100% of the time. And I think if we say we are, then we need to talk. I want to know the secret. But are we, you know, do we postpone obedience to God? This is what happened with the people of Israel in Haggai here. Let's look at, I'm going to go right to verse 2. Haggai chapter 1 and verse 2. It says, thus speaks the Lord of hosts, saying, this people says, the time has not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built. Now, again, think about the literal and the figurative meanings of house here. Yes, they're talking about the temple, but to us, this means the temple of God in us, we individually, as a Christian. Let me read that again. The time has not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built. Can any of us say that about us? Basically, they were saying here that it was not God's will to rebuild the temple at this particular time. Now, I think that's a little scary. to be saying that. In fact, they had been saying this very same thing for the next 15 years. They said, it's not time. It's not time. Supposedly, it wasn't that they were opposed to rebuilding the temple, but they just didn't think the timing was right. Now, my question is, when they came out of exile and they were fired up and on fire for God and His way of life, what changed? What changed? What changed was the attitude. The attitude is what changed. Unfortunately, much too often, if we don't want to do something in our life, our personal life, if we don't want to do something, we will excuse ourselves by saying, it's not a good time. It's not the right time. Maybe later. You know, we think about when we read the Bible and we study hard. We want to dig into something. We read through the Gospels, you know, for example, or whatever it might be. And we're really into it. And I know we've all done this. And then God reveals clarity. I'm not saying He reveals something new, but He reveals clarity in understanding what the Bible is saying. And then we get a strong desire to trust God. Jesus Christ is our Savior. And then we say, well, this is going to require some change. Maybe later. Now, I obviously wouldn't ask for a show of hands, but if I did, what would we say? Can we ever say, yeah, we've done that? And, you know, we've been practicing Christianity, God's Christianity, true Christianity for a long time. Has there ever been a time in our life where we knew it was the right thing to do, but we said maybe later? We're probably all guilty of that. Well, let's think back. You keep your place here in Haggai, but let's think back to remember the story of Felix the governor. So go to Acts, if you will. Paul was speaking to Felix here, Acts 24. And Paul was speaking to him very deeply about Christianity, about what he should be doing, how he should be living. And this is what Felix said. This was his reply. Acts 24 and verse 25. Now, as Paul reasoned about righteousness, about self-control, and the judgment to come, we all face this. Felix was afraid, and Felix answered. He said, go away for now. When I have a convenient time, I will call for you. Wow. We must realize that postponing obedience to God is the very same thing as disobedience. It's what it is. Just a different way to say it. Postponing obedience to God is the same as disobedience. When people make excuses for postponing obedience to God, they may feel that they have a pretty good reason to do this. And it's no different than the people in Haggai's day. These were God's people. They probably thought that they had a good reason for postponing the construction or the finishing, completing of the temple. So now I want to give you three common reasons that we all may be guilty of using for postponing obedience to God. And then I'll give a brief rebuttal to each one of these. The first one, and I don't know if this is point two or point A, it's just the first one. Three common reasons for postponing obedience to God. This one is because it is a difficult time. It's a difficult time. The people here had returned from this exile with great anticipation, and they were very enthusiastic for rebuilding. It ran high in their life. It was high on their list, their priority list. So they went and they laid the foundation. But the difficulties seemed a little insurmountable, just a little too much for them to bear. This is what they came to realize. I mean, after all, think about it. The economy was awful at that time. for these people. The economy was bad since they were recovering from this devastation from the Babylonians, what they'd brought on. I mean, their city, their houses, they all laid in rubble. They destroyed it. We've all seen pictures of war-torn cities. I mean, the one that comes to my mind is Hiroshima, you know. What that city looked like after the bomb was dropped. It was leveled. It was flattened. That is a result of war. This is what the people saw here. Obviously, it wasn't a bomb, but they went in and they destroyed the city. They killed people. They took them prisoner. This is what the people started seeing. And they thought, wow, this is too much. This is more than I want to do. The cities, the houses, they laid in rubble. The walls of Jerusalem were torn down. And this land had been laid in neglect for over 50 years now at this point. Over 50 years, nothing had been done to it. The number of those who returned from the exile was pretty small, relatively speaking. Most of them stayed in Babylon and Persia. Think about that. They all were taken captive, and a majority of them stayed. They got used to their surroundings. They stayed. Think about that, how that relates to us spiritually. That's a little scary. They've got complacent. These ones that came back and started looking around and were supposed to be building the temple, they noticed the Samaritans and their other neighbors. These people were opposing them. So now they have to fight against these people as well. So they rationalized in their minds, and they decided that it was not the right time. Not the right time. Maybe later. Maybe things will get easier later. It wasn't the right time. Here's the thing. Just because something is difficult and hard and it's going to cost us individually something, a high price, it does not mean that it is not God's will. And that's what we have to remember. God never once said living his way of life was easy. Come and do it. He did say his yoke was light if we take it. He did say he will be there to help us along. He will never leave us or forsake us. He did say anytime we need a help, a hand, or whatever, call on him. He would be there. But he didn't say it was going to be a walk in the park. Some could have said that Pentecost, 31 AD, Pentecost wasn't a good time to start the church. I mean, think about it. They only had 120 faithful members in Jerusalem. Of all the people that was in Jerusalem, Jerusalem, a booming city, 120 people. They could have said, it's not a good time. It's not right. Maybe later. Religious leaders there, they just early on crucified this rabbi named Jesus Christ. But here is the thing. When God's Spirit is involved and it fills a group of people, things happen. Things get done. And it is always a good time to do the work of God, no matter where we are, no matter what the circumstances are. And that's what they found themselves with in Pentecost 31 AD. That's what these people Hezekiah's day were just about to realize. But it's going to take a little more convincing. You know, today, we are living in some very uncertain times. We just finished an election, and there's still a lot of strife and turmoil with that. We don't know how it's going to turn out. We know the results, yes, but we don't know what's going to happen come middle of January when offices change, when different powers get in. We don't know what's going to happen. The stock market, it's all over the place. It's up, it's down, it looks good, and you can wake up tomorrow and it'll be bottomed out. It's uncertain times. The economy could take a downturn at any time. What would that do? How bad would that affect us? Unemployment, it could just rise in numbers that we've not seen forever. Here's what we have to realize. as uncertain as these times are, our economy today is not nearly as bad as it was in Haggai's day. It's not nearly as bad as it was then. Yet I'm sure some have thought with the Israelites, the time is not yet that the Lord's house should be built. We need to take that personally. The time is not yet that the temple of God, us, should be built. Yes, it is. The time is now. It is time for us to add to, improve, build, whatever we have to do, the temple of God now. We can't afford to wait. If we waited until all the circumstances were favorable, then we would absolutely never accomplish anything. Okay, my next point. Point B, maybe. Because others or other matters seem more important. Because other matters seem more important. Well, let's go back to Haggai chapter 1, if you kept your place there. Notice what God asks. And it's a very, very direct question. Makes you think. Makes these people think. It did make them think. Haggai verse 4, chapter 1, verse 4. He said, God said this, "Is it time for you yourselves to dwell in your paneled houses and this temple to lie in ruins?" Now, if we're just reading over this very quickly, we might not give that a lot of thought. But we're not. We're going to look into this a little bit deeper. Because this is a life-changing question. This is a question that makes all the difference. And it made all the difference in their day, too. The people here were putting their priorities on their own houses, their own personal dwellings, their own personal effects, whatever that they thought they needed. They were saying, "Hey, we have homes to build. We have children to educate. We have businesses to establish." And on the surface, you think about those answers, or those replies, and they're all legitimate. They're legitimate concerns. And it is true that our family should be very, very high on our priority list. But we can take that to extremes. And we have to understand that no matter what, absolutely no matter what, God comes first. God comes first. That is the bottom line. God comes first. We have to make sure this is consistent in our life and made of high importance. We said what changed in the Israelites coming out of exile was their attitude. And that is exactly the truth. Our attitude towards church activities, towards buildings, towards personal preferences that we choose to, how we choose to grow our spiritual life. All this, everything that we do here gives a very loud and vocal message to our children. And it gives that same message to the community. The question is, what are we saying? Are we saying that God is first? When the people drive up and down the street here, do they look at this church, the people, and do they say, "It's pretty obvious that God's first in their life"? I don't know. I hope they do. That should be our goal, to have them say that, because that's what we want. Are we saying that church really is important? I hope we're not saying that. If that's the message that's being presented, and if that's the message that people are getting as they drive by and look at us, then we do need to reevaluate what we're doing and how we're doing it. And I don't think that's the case at all. But we can't afford to let that be the case. Are we saying that by our actions that TV and other things are more important than worshiping God? By our actions. In other words, yes, we're all here today, and that's a great thing. That's the way it should be. But are we going to worship God tomorrow? Now, I'm not saying Sunday service. But I mean tomorrow, the next day, every day. Are we going to worship God every day? We should. Every day of our life, we should worship God. That has to become the most important thing in our life. But here's the thing. One day, all of this, this physical, it's going to be over. And if we haven't came to the point in our life where we worship God first and foremost, where are we going to be? It's a question we need to think about. I want to give you results of a study done in 2005. This is the Barna survey. They surveyed so many people, and the results were this. Only one out of every seven adults, that's 15%, only one of every seven adults placed their faith in God and their trust in God at the top of their priority list. One in seven. Now, I guess that doesn't surprise me, because I hope and I pray that all of us would be that one of the seven. And it doesn't say who they asked, but this was just a general survey. And there's not a whole lot of true, honest, dedicated Christians in the world. There's not. One out of every seven. Other things seem to be more important than the general public. They just don't put God and His plan very high on the list. And I think that's sad. And I'm sure God is saddened by that, because this is not His idea, His plan, as He started. You know, He says that He wants absolutely everyone to come into His family. Not one in seven. Look at what Christ said, a very familiar scripture. You might hold your place there again. Go to Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33. We probably don't even need to turn there. We know this one by heart. Matthew 6, verse 33. But I want to read it. I want you to look at it and see it in your own Bible. Matthew 6, verse 33. This is what God says. This is what we do. He said, "Seek first the kingdom of God, and then all of His righteousness. And if we do this, all these things will be added to you." When we put God first in our lives, everything else that matters to us, because what matters to us does matter to God. He is a loving Father, a caring Father. So when we put God first and we seek His righteousness to be what guides us and patterns our life, when we do that, He will make sure that we're taken care of. He will bless us. He promises He will. That's what we have to understand. The things that people are after today, they may not be wrong. God wants us to have nice things. He wants us to be well off. So those things aren't wrong. But it is wrong when we put those things first in our lives and we use them for our own gain. That's when it's wrong. I believe that we should show by use of our time, by use of our talents, our labor, or whatever it might be, that the church, and the church is the individual people sitting here, it's not the building, but I believe that we should show the church, God's house, God's people, that it is the most important place there is on earth until Christ returns. This is Christ's dwelling place. We, in us, should be Christ's dwelling place. It is the temple of God. Our church, our group, us, we should say to the community that what we are doing here is the most important thing in our life. And that should come out without us having to say it. It should be what is repelled, what is omitted from us. We shouldn't have to say it. Area number three, or C, we need to make sure that our priorities are in the right place, because people are satisfied with the way things are. People are satisfied with the way things are. You know, you go back to Hezekiah here, and they've already built an altar to God. Haggai, Hezekiah. I've got, I don't know why I keep saying Hezekiah, Haggai. We go back to here, the people of Haggai's time, they built this altar to God, and they may build a tabernacle, but many felt that that was enough, at least for now, for that time. They felt that they had done enough. Have we ever, in serving God, in serving God's people, think that we have done enough? I mean, yeah, we get tired. We're human. But don't quit. These people thought they had done enough. The people have grown accustomed to living in a city without a temple. They had become complacent. And this is a very high danger for all of us, becoming complacent. So often, we become satisfied with going second or third class when it comes to the things of God. And we need to reprogram ourselves that we will not settle for anything less than first class when it comes to things of God. We need to make sure that we do that. We need to reprogram ourselves to where that is the case. The greatest enemy of progress is satisfaction with the way things are. Let's go back to Haggai here. We'll look at some more things here in just a minute. Here in Haggai chapter 1, we see a group of God's people who have put the work of God on the back burner of their lives. And they became okay with that. And that's what's scary. So we have to ask ourselves, have we ever fallen into that trap, becoming okay with where we are in our Christianity? Now, I'm not saying that any of us are bad Christians, but I am saying that every one of us, myself included, can be better Christians. None of us are perfect yet, but we are to strive for perfection. Was there ever a time when we used to be far more excited and active in the church as a whole? For all the people here in Haggai's day, their excuses were invalid. God didn't buy their excuse. They were simply out of God's will. And that is scary. When you think about that, being out of God's will, and we put our own name in there, am I, Kevin, out of God's will? Wow, that's scary. We don't want to fall into that. God was very displeased with their attitude and their lack of action. Now, from a human standpoint, when somebody in power becomes very displeased with somebody's attitude and actions, they either fire them, they lock them up, or they kill them. That's usually what happens. But that's not God. God sent the prophet Haggai to the people here. And he sent Haggai to appeal to them. This truly is an act of mercy and love from God the Father. So instead of postponing obedience to God, I have this as point number two, after one, A, B, and C. Point number two, we should listen to God's word. These are just basic, but this is what Haggai is saying. We should listen to God's word. You know, Haggai repeatedly refers in his, the first chapter here, to the word of God. The word of God. The word of the Lord. He says this over and over. He's making it very clear that he is not speaking his own thoughts here. These are actually God's thoughts. He's just the messenger. He's just bringing them to the people. That's what God told him to do. And that's what he's doing. He wants the people to understand this is what God is saying. And this is no different than today. We read God's word, the Bible. These are God's words. It's not my words or anybody else's words. This is God's words. This is what God wants us to say. What we have to understand is this is my job. And it's not just my job. Every one of you who get up here and give messages, it's your job too. Now, I'm going to put a little pressure on you. Because when you realize that this is your job, this is my job, it's our job, the responsibilities are tremendous. Yes, we can't get anybody into the kingdom, but we can give the direction from the Bible to get you on the right track. Responsibility is not just us as speakers. It's all of us as God's people. It goes back to we have to work out our own salvation. We have to listen to God's word. We have to read it, study it, and then act on it. We should listen to God's word. If we notice Haggai here, he encourages the people. And I think this is, obviously this is very godly, the way he went about this, the way God inspired him to go about this. He encourages the people to listen to God, and then they do, and then he asks for a response, and they do. So I have another subpoint here. I couldn't even tell you what this one is. But he appeals to their mind. This is the point, he appeals to their mind. And I want to go back and look at verse 4 again here of Haggai, because we'll see this very important question again. This is a life-changing question. God said to them in verse 4, "Is it time for you yourself to dwell in your paneled houses and this temple to lie in ruins?" A simple question, but it has a very deep meaning. He asked them to think about what is going on in your life. That's what he's saying here. What is going on in your life? They said, yeah, the economy's bad. The circumstances are bad. Everything around us is bad. It's run. And we have not yet been able to build your temple. But we did find time to build a nice house for ourselves, a nice dwelling, a paneled home. Now, you know, we would expect that they should take care of their families and build some sort of a house or a shelter, whatever it takes to get your family out of the weather, out of the elements. But when you take 15 years to do this, priorities are wrong. The principle here is very clear. Each and every one of us should not be willing to do less for God than we do for ourselves. And that's what they didn't see. They were doing this. Keep your place here. Go to 2 Samuel chapter 7. This is where King David, he said, he was talking to Nathan, the prophet. King David came to a realization here. He was a very wise man. 2 Samuel 7, verse 2. He simply said this, "See now, I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwells inside tents, curtains." He was understanding, wait a minute, something's wrong here. Something's off. He didn't feel right about living in a nicer house, a nicer physical house than the presence of God. So, I hope this doesn't offend anybody, but this becomes sin. This becomes sin. Now, this is how it becomes sin. It becomes sin when we put our own desires in front of the will of God. That's when it becomes sin. David recognized this, and he wanted to fix it. He wanted to change it. You know, the weather is too bad to go to church today. It's too bad to go out and visit people. But it's not too bad to go on a hunting trip, or it's not too bad to go shopping. These are invalid reasons. They're invalid excuses. I wouldn't even say they're reasons. They're excuses. People will sit through doubleheader baseball games. 7 hours of baseball. I love baseball. 7 hours of baseball. And they will do this and never complain unless their team's losing. But they'll never complain. Yet, they will start to fidget in church services when it goes 5 minutes overtime. Think about that. We probably are guilty of it. I'll read you a quote here from C.S. Lewis. He said this, "The only thing Christianity cannot be is moderately important." Absolutely. It has to be of utmost importance. True Christianity. If we are going to be true Christians, it has to be first in our life. And if that really is true, then it absolutely deserves everything that we have, everything that we can put into it. Because we're not doing it for ourselves, we're doing it for God. And in that, God rewards us. So I guess you could argue the fact, well, we're doing it for ourselves. Well, if we keep a self attitude, then we will only go to here. But when we change that attitude to God, then we will rise above. And we will go where God wants us to go. Next point here is he appeals to their heart. Go back to Haggai, please. He appeals to their heart. You know, twice in verses 5 and 7, Christ says, consider your ways. Now, the literal Hebrew meaning of this is set your heart upon your ways. Now, when you think, just you read over this, and we've probably read it 100 times, and consider your ways. Okay, I've considered it, I'm moving on. But think about what it really means. Set your heart on your ways. That's taking it deeper. That's making it personal. And it is personal. Think about what we're doing to the deepest level. And then move on. He's telling them to take a good hard look at their life. And then make the right choices. You have to consider the problem, though. And that's what they needed to do. Look at verse 6 here. Haggai 1, verse 6. He asked them to consider. He said that you have sown much and you bring in little. You eat but do not have enough. You drink but you are not filled with drink. You clothe yourself but no one is warm. And he who earns wages to put into a bag with holes. Now look at verses 10 and 11. Their farms were unproductive as well. Verse 10 and 11. Therefore the heavens above you withhold the dew, and the earth withholds its fruit. For I call for a drought on the land and the mountains, and on the grain and on the new wines and the oils, on whatever the grounds bring forth, on men and livestock, and on all the labors of your hands. You go back and look at the prosperity, or we should say the lack thereof. It wasn't they didn't have it. They didn't keep it. The wages they earned, it says here, they seem to evaporate or disappear. Again, like money pits. It says here, earn wages to put into bags with holes. They were gone. Have you ever had something very, very valuable that you had in your pocket or your purse even? Something was personal. And you went to reach in there, and it wasn't there. Because there was a hole in your pocket, or a hole in your purse. You remember that feeling you had? That sorrowful feeling in the pit of your stomach. What are you going to do? This is what these people started to feel like. Wow. They're starting to understand. So in spite of all their hard work, all their labors, they were just not getting ahead. They weren't making any progress. They took one step forward and two steps back. They were putting their own interests above God's. And they weren't getting anywhere. They didn't quite make the connection. Nothing seemed to go right for these people. You know, there's no more telling a description of the frustration of a self-centered life than what is given here in Haggai chapter 1. The more we focus on our own happiness aside from God, the more unhappy we become. Aside from God is the key. A life without God at the center is one of unsatisfied hunger and thirst. It can't be satisfied. We can buy, we can gain all the material things we can get our hands on. But if God is not at the center, then it is meaningless. It will not satisfy us. And even if we successfully feed our bodies, you know, we don't starve to death, we can starve spiritually. Go to Psalms, if you will. Psalms chapter 106. Psalms 106 and verse 15. Psalms 106 verse 15 says, "And he gave them their requests, but sent leanness into their soul." He gave them their requests. God wants us to bring all of our requests before him, but we have to do it in a way that pleases him. We have to live our life in a way that pleases him. If we are out for gain, and get all we can get, and we don't really have God centered in our life, we don't know how he will answer our prayer. We do know he will, but we don't know how. Here it says he gave them their requests. He gave them what they asked for, but sent leanness to their soul. They were dying spiritually. They were dying spiritually. Have we ever found ourselves in a similar situation? You know, putting a priority on making money. And there's nothing wrong with making money. We have to have money to live in this world. But I said putting a priority on making money, even above God and our family. If we do that, we usually find out that we're not getting anywhere. We're not gaining ground. Or maybe we're making more money than we ever did before, but we feel like that we have less than we ever had before. Why is that? We feel like what is said here in verse 6, that we're putting our money in buckets with holes in it. We have a lot coming in, but there's not a lot left over. It's disappearing. If this is the case in our life, we need to do what he said in verses 5 through 7. Consider our ways. Consider our ways. When bad things happen, we should be willing to consider why they are happening. Actions have consequences, and consequences have causes. It all goes together. So you should not only think about the problem we're facing, but also consider the reason for the problems. That's another point. And that's probably one of those two or three number two points. Consider the reason for our problems. You know, why were they experiencing all these troubles back in Haggai's day? Haggai was sent by God to interpret their calamities and tell them what the problem was, tell them what the deal was. Go back, if you're not in Haggai, go back to Haggai. God spoke through him in verse 9. This is what he said. Haggai 1 verse 9. "You looked for much, but indeed it came to little. And when you brought it home, I blew it away." Why? See, that kind of changes things now. God, I blew it away. Why? Says the Lord of hosts. Why would God do such a thing? Then he gives them the reasons that they were having such problems. "Because of my house that is in ruins, while every one of you runs to his own house." Remember early on, we read that they were living in these houses with panels. That's a pretty nice house back then. And the temple was laying in ruins. They were having trouble because they were living in disobedience to God, keeping everything for themselves and giving nothing to God. Their service, nothing was going to God. And there is consequences for our actions. Here's a double curse. Instead of much, very little was reaped. And the little that was brought to them, God then blew that away. So it was a double whammy. God cannot bless us in any way, financially, physically, whatever, if we are neglecting to support Him, to live for Him, to obey Him. If we're neglecting that, He will not bless us. In Haggai's day, God was chastising them concerning their material things, and they were not recognizing it as His judgment. They didn't see what the real picture was. Look at Hebrews chapter 12, if you will. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 7. It says this, if you endure chastening, God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom a father chastens, or whom a father does not chasten? Sometimes it feels like God is rubbing us with sandpaper. We've all felt that. And it can be very rough at times. But we have to realize when this is going on in our life that He may be just trying to, smooth out the rough edges of our lives, trying to get us back in shape, in the Christian shape that we need to be in. The problem back in Haggai here was that the people did not recognize their trouble. They were in so deep that they didn't recognize it. And this is a common thing. A lot of times people get into a situation and they're so involved in it that they don't see the real thing. It's hard to back out and see the real thing. These people didn't see it. They didn't see their trouble. They didn't see it as being related to disobedience to God. And that's exactly what it was. They were not considering their ways. He tells us, consider your ways. They weren't doing it. They thought that they had a good excuse in postponing the building of the temple. But that doesn't make it right. A good excuse does not make it right. You don't have to turn there, but Proverbs 14 and verse 12. We all know this scripture. It says this, there is a way that seems right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. We don't want to make the same mistakes that these people made. When things go wrong in our life, do we consider why? Do we consider our ways? What path are we taking? Where's that path leading? Is it leading to God, to God's kingdom? If it's not, then we have to readjust. Sin will often bring a short time pleasure, but it won't last. And the end of it will be suffering, will be broken hearts, will be wrecked lives. I do not believe that every time bad things happen, that it means God is punishing us. I don't believe that at all. We live in a world, a fallen world, where sin happened a long, long time ago. And it still happens. And don't get me wrong, we do still sin. But in this world, this fallen world that we live in, bad things happen to even godly people, even righteous people. But when bad things happen, as a person, a child of God, no matter what, the first thing we should do is consider our ways. Consider the path we're on. Is that path going the wrong way? Or is it all right? And we have to make the choice to stay the course or to make an adjustment. We ought to turn to God's Word and look at God's Word and seek answers from Him in absolutely everything that we do. Then, if and when, we realize that we have been on a pathway of disobedience, then that's when we should change. That's when we should fix it. As long as we can take a breath, we can fix it. The next response here to the appeal of Haggai is another subpoint. He appeals to their will for action. Haggai, he appeals for their will to action. Go back to Haggai again, if you will. A remedy for the conditions of verse 6 that we read earlier is stated in verse 8. And this is the remedy. This is what he tells them to do. It seems so simple once we read it. Go up to the mountain and bring wood and build the temple, that I may take pleasure in it and be glorified, says the Lord. Get back on course. Do what you were doing. Complete the task. That's what he's telling them. He's saying that the time for God's work to be done is now. Don't wait. Don't wait till tomorrow. None of us, absolutely none of us, know if we have tomorrow. We definitely don't know if we have next week or next year. We only know that we have the here and now. The time for God's work to be done or be doing is now, to the best of our ability. It will involve steps to a plan of obedience. First, these people here, they would need to go and get materials for the building of this temple. He told them, go to the mountain and bring wood and build the temple. So they have to go. This implies something. They have to go. This involves taking action. This involves doing work. You go up to the mountain, cut down the trees. They're not just going to fall down themselves. You have to cut them down. Then you have to drag them out. Then you have to make lumber out of them. And then you have to put a great deal of work and effort into this. Here's the thing. God never said a Christian life was easy. It involves work. It involves discipline. And it involves commitment. And we have to stay and do it, no matter in good times or bad. All through God's Word, all through the Bible, the value of work is commanded. The opposite of work is being lazy. And we know what that leads, and we know what God says about the slacker and the lazy one. We're going to have to roll up our sleeves. We're going to have to work harder now than we ever have. We can't just sit on sidelines and expect God to do it, because God has called us. God presents the material. He presents the way, but he expects us to take action, and that's what he wants us to do. So having heard the appeals to our mind and our heart and our will, another point is we should respond to God's word. We should respond to God's word. You're thankful the people here of Israel, they responded. And it took them a little while. They had to be convinced. But that is no different than us. You know, none of us, not very many of us, jump on a change right away. When we're doing something and somebody points out that it's wrong, we don't just immediately say, okay, I'm going to fix it. We usually back up and we take a while. You know, we read something about the hard-headed, the stiff-necked Israelites. Well, we kind of fall into that too. But these people, these Israelites, they responded well to the teachings of Haggai. They listened to what he had to say. They were not like so many people today. I heard a story of a deer hunter, a guide, who took two men hunting. Now, these two men, one was a preacher, and one was a doctor. And he took these two guys hunting. They'd never been deer hunting before in their life. And I'm kind of partial to deer hunting, and it's deer season, so I thought this is appropriate. So he took them to deer hunt. He got them in a tree stand. And within just a matter of minutes, this big deer came out. Boom! Both of them shot at the same time. Exact same rifles, same bullets. Everything was the same. The deer dropped in his tracks. They shot at the same time, and now there was a problem. Who killed the deer? Each person claimed that they're the one that shot the deer. It's my deer. The guide said, wait here, and I'll go check the deer. So he walked up to the deer. He inspected the wound on the deer, and he yelled back, I know who shot the deer. The preacher did. His bullet went in one ear and out the other. Well, okay. The people of Haggai, they did not ignore Haggai. They listened. It took a little while, but they listened. They considered their ways. And this is what he wanted them to do. This is what God wanted them to do. They considered their ways, and then they took action. They reacted to what God, through Haggai, was telling them. they reacted in a positive way. And that's the way it should be today. You don't have to turn there, but James 1 verse 22 says this: be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. When we become hearers only, we are deceiving ourselves. And essentially, we're taking God out of our life. We have to be doers. We have to, and that implies taking action, doing something. So how should we respond to God's word? By obeying God. By obeying, by listening and obeying. That's what the people did in Haggai's day. And that's the response that God is looking for today. Look at verse 12 here. Haggai 1 verse 12. Then Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, with all the remnant of the people, obeyed the voice of the Lord their God and the words of Haggai the prophet, as the Lord their God had sent him. And the people feared the presence of the Lord. Now drop down to verse 14. So the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and the spirit of all the remnant of the people. You notice that? And they came, and they worked on the house of the Lord of hosts, their God. This is absolutely great. This is a perfect example of God throwing out a command, the people hearing the command, and the people taking it to heart, and then action. This is absolutely great. Within 3 weeks, a few days after his first address to the people, they began to work on the project. They realized this is what they considered their ways. This is what we need to do. Within 3 weeks, they started. They were not just hearers of the word, but they became doers. And that's it. The point is, it's never too late for any of us, as long as we are taking a breath. It's never too late. One of the messages at the feast, they were talking about this, and the question was posed, how much time do I have to become a full Christian? And the answer was, you have your lifetime. And that's a valid answer, because nobody knows. We don't know if we have another day, another year, 10 years. We don't know. But we have that long. The question is, what are we going to do with it? The greatest compliment you will ever give a person is for the person to see that you are putting into practice what you have been instructed, as long as it follows God's ways. That is the greatest compliment you will ever give somebody. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 15. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22. Samuel said this. 1 Samuel 15, verse 22. To obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams. To obey God. It's better than any of the physical blessings that we can get. It's better than anything this world, this life has to offer. They started giving priority to the work and the Word of God. It is significant that the leaders of the people here, Zerubbabel and Joshua, they're mentioned first in obedience to God. And that's not just a coincidence. That shows leading by example. This reflects Jesus Christ. He led. He came to earth and he led by example. The general population also responded. This was a united response. This is what we seek. Now notice why the people obeyed. It was because the people feared the presence of the Lord. And that was a healthy fear. It wasn't a, I'm afraid you're going to smite me or strike me down. It was a healthy, a godly fear. And that's what they had, a healthy fear of respect for God. And that's good for all of us. We need that in our life. The Israelites were obedient because they realized that Haggai here was actually speaking the words of God and not mere words of man. That's the other thing. They realized that Haggai was speaking the words of God. Finally, let's look at verse 14. We read it once. I want to read it again. So the Lord stirred up the spirit in Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and the spirit of all the remnant of the people. And they came and they worked on the house of the Lord of hosts, their God. It wasn't just limited to the leaders. It included everybody. According to Ezra 6 and verse 15, this task of the temple was completed in 4 years. I'll just read it to you, Ezra 6 and verse 15. It says, Now the temple was finished on the third day of the month of Adar, which was in the sixth year of the reign of King Darius. This was 4 years later. I think that's very incredible. Now, I didn't read verse 13. Let's look at it. In verse 13 we read, Then Haggai, the Lord's messenger, spoke the Lord's message to the people, saying, I am with you, says the Lord. Very, very important. Because this goes to each and every one of us today. He is with us. The task here was great. It was huge. But God promised to be with them, to help them every step of the way, in everything in their life they did. When we obey God, and we place our faith and trust in Him, and we put Him first in our life, the Bible, God's Word, assures us that we will not be alone, no matter what. And that is incredibly encouraging. Many times in their nation's past, Israel went into battle, and they were greatly outnumbered. But God promised to be with them, and He gave them the victory that He promised, even though they were outnumbered. Even so, with God's help, we can do what seems to be impossible. We can get through it, and we can do it. I'm going to close with one final section of Scripture in Malachi 3. If we trust God and put our faith and hope in Him and put Him first in our life, He will enable us to have a very huge part in His great work. If we are faithful in putting Him first in everything that we do, He will shower us with blessings. Malachi 3, verses 10 and 11 says this. God says, Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now on this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you a window of heaven and pour out for you such blessings that there will not be room enough to receive it. And I will rebuke and devour for your sakes, so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground, nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. God makes a lot of promises throughout the Bible, and He follows through on every one of them. He promises if we put Him first, if we set our priorities straight, He will bless us. It says here, there will not be room enough to receive it. Has anybody had that many blessings in their life? Probably not. We have our priorities. Where are they? We all have priorities. Where are they? And what are they? What order are they in? It is absolutely time to put our house in order, physically and spiritually, to put God first in our life. Remember again, He said, seek first the kingdom and His righteousness. And if you do that, if you do it the way it should be done, everything else will be added to you. He will take care of us. Brethren, we put God first. We trust Him, and He will meet our needs, every one of them, no matter how big or how small. And He will satisfy our spiritual hunger and our spiritual thirst. It is time to make sure that we have our spiritual house in order, and we seek God continually.